is about a mortgage banker turned Robin Hood who decides to manipulate mortgage records to keep people's homes out of foreclosure. And it's also about a cold case, the Lilac Sunday killing, a murder in the Arnold Arboretum, unsolved from 20 years ago. And it's also about a reporter who makes stuff up. So it's all about truth be told. And when I said truth be told, I thought, oh, there it is, there it is.
Agatha award-winning mystery author Hank Phillippi Ryan, who also is an investigative reporter on NBC's affiliate, Channel 7 in Boston, recently talked about her award-winning latest release, Truth Be Told, at the Hopkinton Public Library. She talked about her experience as a reporter and how she got into writing. The audience also had a chance to ask her questions.
I've been a television reporter for 40 years, and I've wired myself with hidden cameras and confronted corrupt politicians and gone undercover and disguise. But I'm here in my second career as a crime fiction author. Starting about 10 years ago, I started writing murder mystery novels. I'm on my seventh one now, which just won the Agatha for Best Mystery of the Year, called Truth Be Told. So I'm here tonight in Hopkinton, talking to other people who love mysteries and love reading and love books. And we're talking about reading and writing and television and the mysteries of television. What influenced me to get into writing? I've always wanted to be a mystery author ever since I was a little girl. I love storytelling, and I love mysteries, and I love creating puzzles and suspense. So instead, I went into investigative reporting. I've been a reporter for many years now. And I learned that it's all about telling a great story with characters who you care about and a problem that needs to be solved. And I started thinking that maybe it would be fun just to make stuff up. You know, what I do for Channel 7 as an investigative reporter, I've won 32 Emmys for telling the truth. And I wondered if I could use my imagination to create a brand new world, a brand new story. And that's what I've done in the Jane Ryland thrillers. They take place in Boston and New England, about an investigative reporter on the trail of a good story. So they're fun, they're fast-paced. If you like Harlan Coben, Lisa Scottolini, Tess Gerritsen, they're authentically New England. They're page-turning, riveting thrillers. Library Journal starred review said, drop everything and binge read, Truth Be Told. Where people can find more information about me, I have a website, hankphillippiryan.com, that has all kinds of great stuff, cool photos, cool videos, all of my events, and all the information about all my books, including the new one, What You See, which comes out October 20th.
All right, I think we're ready to start now. I'm Beth Mezet from Friends of the Library, and it gives me great pleasure to introduce our speaker tonight, Hank Phillippi Ryan. Ms. Ryan is the winner of 32 Emmys and 32 Edward R. Murrow Awards, among other honors, for journalism. Here in New England, we've known her as Help Me Hank on the air as investigative reporting on Boston's NBC affiliate News. She's also the best-selling author of Seven Mysteries. In her non-journalist role, Ms. Ryan has been called a master at crafting suspenseful mysteries and a superb and gifted storyteller. In the past, her books have won multiple awards for crime fiction, including 3 Agathas, an Anthony, Daphne, McCavity, and the coveted Mary Higgins Clark Award. She's a founding teacher at Mystery Writers of America University and was the 2013 president of the National Sisters in Crime Organization. Ms. Ryan's 2013 novel, The Wrong Girl, won the Agatha Award for Best Contemporary Novel and the Daphne Award for Mainstream Mystery Suspense, and has been on the Boston Globe bestseller list for 7 weeks. Now her 2014 book, Truth Be Told, has won another Agatha Award for the Best Contemporary Novel, and I understand that winning back-to-back is an unprecedented thing in the world of mystery writing.
It's interesting and yes. Wonderful. I think only Louise Penny has done that.
Ah, okay. Truth Be Told is also the Library Journal's Best Book of 2014, and it's an RT Book Review's nominee for Best Suspense Thriller of 2014, a Library Journal Editor's Pick, and the RT Book Review's Top Pick. There are starred reviews from Booklist and from Library Journal. The Journal recommends people drop everything and binge read, truth be told. And I'll attest to it. That's the best
way to
approach
it. That's a good review, right?
In the category of nonfiction, Ms. Ryan has recently won the Agatha Award for the best nonfiction for Rites of Passage. And that was also this year, I understand.
Yes.
And that's an anthology of essays by mystery writers. Her next novel, What You See, will be out in the fall. Please welcome Hank Phillippi Ryan.
Thank you. Thank you so much for coming tonight. I can't make the microphone from the library attached to my jacket. So can you hear me? Are you okay? And now I also have a microphone that does attach from the TV station, and it's precarious. So in the middle of this is suspense. So this is how suspense works. Sometime during my speech, this microphone might fall off. That's the way to get you just to look at me, right, the whole time and let me know. So if you hear a thunk, that's what's happened. I am so pleased to be here tonight in this beautiful, amazing library. It's not snowing. Can you believe that? I've been on book tour, and I was just in Florida, and I was trying to explain to the cab driver in Florida the kind of winter that we had. And I was, you have to imagine us in Vero Beach, palm trees, sand, that yellow thing in the sky. And I'm saying to him, we had 100 inches of snow. I'm 5'8", and we had, what's that, 68 inches? And we had 100 inches of snow. I said, the snow was over the cars. And this guy's like, no. And it sounded so outrageous that I began not to believe that it had actually happened, that we had actually lived through it. So now my tulips are up and the squirrels are eating the tulips and all's right with the world. Does anybody have any ideas about how to, we can talk later. Anyway, so glad to be.
Plant tulips.
Oh, there's a that is a solution. Not planting tulips is the solution. Well, maybe we'll try that. I'm so glad to be here in your beautiful library. Libraries have been such a part of my life since I was a little girl. I grew up in really rural Indiana, so rural that you couldn't see another house from our house, and like you. And my sister in Indiana?
Yes.
Where?
A town called Rushville.
Rushville, of course, in southern Indiana.
Yes.
I grew up in Zionsville, in central Indiana, and the town was so small. Well, let me put it this way. My sister and I used to ride our ponies to the library to get books, and we would fill up the saddlebags with books and then ride back home and read up in the hayloft of our barn. So libraries have always been so very important to me. Then as an investigative reporter, I've been a reporter for 40 years. As an investigative reporter, I also went to the library to do research. Before the days of the internet, you had to actually go to the library to look stuff up. I actually used the microfiche. Remember that? Oh, who invented that? What an instrument of torture that was. And the newspaper reader machine, where it had you had to do research, and there was no table of contents, and you couldn't figure out where anything was. And I would always be distracted by it. Like, I would look at the ads and say, oh, look at that, a hat for 50 cents. That's so interesting. So it was a problem, that research. And then, of course, who but the reference librarian at libraries, the research librarians, were the knower of all knowledge. And so I have called many a librarian to find out information for my investigative stories. And my secret was that when I was working late at night and the Boston Public Library was closed, I realized that all I had to do was call California, where the libraries were still open, right, and use the time zones to my advantage and get 3 more hours of working. So I'm incredibly grateful to libraries and spent so much time there as a kid. So you can imagine when my thriller started coming out, what a complete joy it was to go to the library and see my books on the shelves, with my name and my picture and all those words that I had worked so hard to do. And the first book in the series that came out, though, well, it looks like this. It says, I realized it said, Hank Phillippe Ryan, the other woman. Which nobody had really thought about, you know, until we saw that. This book won the Mary Higgins Clark Award, so you know what that is, right? It's for suspense that has no graphic sex, no graphic violence, a good, strong puzzle story with a great female main character. But it does have a funny, it does have a funny juxtaposition of the title. And then when the next book came out the next year, Hank Phillippe Ryan, The Wrong Girl. And you'd think somebody might have told me that along the way. This book won the Agatha, though, for best novel of 2013, and so I'm really thrilled with that. It's been quite a ride. So the third book in the series, which is just out, we changed up the title a little bit, so now it says Hank Phillippe Ryan, Truth Be Told, right, which is far better for an investigative reporter. And this book was just named Library Journal Best of 2014 and just won the Agatha for Best Mystery of the Year. This is, you know, when you think about, you know, I read up in the hayloft of that barn for so many years, and that's where I fell in love with storytelling. You know, with Nancy Drew and Hercule Poirot and Sherlock Holmes. You know, you read Nancy Drew, right? The Clue in the Old Clock and The Clue in the Diary. Remember this? Which I thought was Clue in the Dairy for like the whole book. And I'm thinking, shouldn't there be cows? You know, I don't know. But that's where I fell in love with storytelling, and that's where I fell in love with mysteries, and that's where I fell in love with Agatha Christie. And so the idea that 50 years later, that little girl in the hayloft, you know, wins the Agatha, named for Agatha Christie, for best mystery, just shows you, you know, the sort of serendipity of the universe and how there's a way that the universe works that we just may not always understand, but we have to really embrace. You know, I've been a television reporter for 40 years. I've wired myself with hidden cameras. I've confronted corrupt politicians. I've gone undercover and in disguise. And there's one thing that I can absolutely tell you. My husband and I don't celebrate the anniversary of the day we met. We celebrate the anniversary of the day before we met. And we call that You Never Know Day. Because you never know what wonderful thing is around the next corner, right? You just don't know what fabulous thing is about to happen. And that has really been the story of my life. When I grew up, I can't even begin to tell you, the most bookish, the most unpopular, the most introverted little girl that you could possibly ever imagine. When I was in junior high, we called it, you know how they vote people most popular, best dressed, most likely to succeed? They voted me most individual. Most individual. What does that mean? That means like most misfit, most doesn't fit in, most not like everybody else. It was awful. They put my picture in the school paper upside down.
Oh,
gee. I know. Tragic. You know, verging on tragic. And, you know, I remember complaining to my mother back then when I was a little girl that life was not fair, that it wasn't fair that this would all happen, and I would whine. And she would say to me, and I can hear her saying it now, you know, get over it, kiddo, because life is not fair. You know, I can hear her saying that. But I think even as a little girl, I decided then that what I wanted to do was, when I grew up, to do something that would matter, to have my life make a difference, to leave a mark of some kind. You know, even then I knew, you know, we get one chance in this universe and we have to take it. We have to do something, that matters. So when I got out of college, I decided, here I go. I'm going to change the world. So with the naivete of somebody who was however old you are when you get out of college, 20, I decided that I would go into politics. Which was may not have been the best or wisest decision, especially since even though I worked in many political campaigns in Indiana, not one candidate I ever worked for actually won. And so that's sort of the universe again saying to you, find another career. So that's when my final candidate lost yet again. That's when I went to the biggest radio station in Indianapolis. And I talked to the news director, and I said, this was 1970-ish, 71, something like that. And I said, I'm here to apply for the job as a reporter. You have a job opening for a reporter. I'm your girl. And so he looks at me, and he says, well, do you have any experience as a reporter? I know the question. I wished that he hadn't asked me that. Do you have any experience as a reporter? Have you ever written a news story? Have you ever written an article? Have you ever done an interview? Have you ever put together a radio story? And I'm shaking my head, you know, no, I don't have anything like that. And he says, did you go to journalism school? No. Did you take journalism classes? No. Were you on the yearbook or the school paper? No. He's like, did you ever hand out little newspapers in your neighborhood when you were a little girl? No. And I see this job, I saw evaporating before my eyes. You know, I wanted to be a reporter and I wanted to change the world, and this was not going to happen. So I was trying to figure out what to do, and I said to him, you know, I don't have any experience of the kind that you're actually talking about, but I grew up here in Indiana and I know where all the streets are, because you kind of have to go with what you've got. And I said, and your license is up for renewal at the FCC right now, and you don't have any women working here. And then I just smiled, and the next day I had my first job in broadcasting. Now, I know, and I tell that story because, first of all, looking back on that now, however many years later, decades later, I can't believe I did that. You know, I can't believe I had the nerve to say that. But I tell the story to journalism classes and to young women especially now, to tell them that in broadcasting at least, it wouldn't work now. If I walked into Channel 7 and I said, you should hire me because I'm a woman, they'd say, you and everybody else in this building, sister. You know, my boss is a woman, and her boss is a woman, and her boss is a woman. And I really think that it shows that with some spirit and with the law behind us and with a little bit of nerve, it shows you that one person can change the world. I mean, that we can make a difference. I mean, who'd have thought back in the day that when you had to get up to change the channel? Do you remember that? You don't even know that you had to get up to change the channel. You had to get up to change the channel. That Diane Sawyer would be anchoring the evening news. You know, that for a while Katie Couric was sitting in Walter Cronkite's chair. That's just crazy. So we never would have predicted that. So I'm really proud to be part of the sort of history of breaking the gender barrier in broadcasting. You know, Barbara Walters and Leslie Stahl and Nancy Dickerson, Diane Sawyer, you know, will tell you that we all got our jobs because we were women, you know, but we couldn't keep them because we were women. So that's a part of my career that I still am proud of. And the other thing that's so amazing about it is that day at the radio station, I took a chance and I found my calling. You know what? And that's been quite amazing. People say to me, "What's the best story you've ever done?" And I always say, "It's the one that's around the next corner. It's the next phone call that I get. It's the next email that I get." In the past 40 years, We've discovered that there was no diversity whatsoever, no people of color at all, in many jury pools, federal jury pools across Massachusetts, which meant that there could be no people of color, no diversity at all in juries in Massachusetts. We've figured out why that happened, and now that's getting changed. We uncovered that we found that emergency responders, police and firefighters, were being sent to the wrong addresses. You call 911, and the firefighter or the ambulance would go to the wrong place because the database was wrong. The addresses in the database were wrong. And we discovered that it happened thousands of times a year, and that the state wasn't even keeping track of it well enough to change the mistakes when they were discovered. And as a result of our story, that system got changed. We also discovered heartbreaking fraud and manipulation in the mortgage banking and home improvement contracting world. And as a result of our story, three new laws were passed. People got their homes out of foreclosure as a result of our story. We got people their homes back, and millions of dollars in refunds and restitution. So it's made a difference. When I think about that, the little girl who wanted to make a difference so many years ago, and now those wonderful stories have occurred, and we're still doing them. And I'll give each and every one of you my business card tonight, because I know that you have stories that you want to tell me. And it's fascinating because those stories and doing those stories for the past 40 years has been such a joy and such an honor, but it's also been such a surprising boon, because I wondered when I started writing crime fiction whether I'd be able to make stuff up. You know, because after all these years as an investigative reporter, I'm only telling you what I see. I'm only telling you what I hear. I can only describe the setting as it really is. I can only report the documents as they really are and the research as they really are. And I wondered if my brain would do that. I wondered if my brain could just create a new world. And what I realized that's so completely fascinating is how those dual careers are actually so similar. Because whether you're making stuff up or whether you're reporting the facts, all that really matters is that you're telling a good story. That's the key, that you have a good story with characters who you care about, with a problem that needs to be solved. You want the good guys to win and the bad guys to get what's coming to them, right? And in the end, you want some justice and you want to change the world a little bit. And whether it's investigative reporting or whether it's writing crime fiction, it's the same. It's the same. It's all about telling a good story. And it's fascinating because you never know, as I said, you never know when that story is coming and when you'll be called on to tell it. A couple of years ago in March, I was at Channel 7, and I knew I was going to have an easy day at work because it was Marathon Monday. And since I'm an investigative reporter and I do long-form, highly researched stories, I don't do general assignment stories anymore. I don't do day of news anymore. So on the day of the marathon, I knew that I had a research day coming, and I was just sort of in my office waiting to go home and doing some research. And I got a call about 3 in the afternoon from my news director, who said, could you get ready to do some breaking news? Could you come down to the newsroom maybe in about 10 minutes? There may be something going on at the marathon. So I said, oh, you know, what happened? And she's like, yeah, we don't know. It may be nothing. So just get ready to go on the air, and we'll let you know when we find out. So, you know, I'm combing my hair and putting on lipstick and getting ready to go on TV. And about 40 seconds later, I would say, she called back, and in a voice I've never heard before, says, come down to the newsroom right now. Come down right now, right now, right now. There's breaking news right now. And when someone has a tone like that, I've never heard that voice. When someone has a tone like that, you don't say, why? What's going on? You know, you just go. And I raced down the two flights of stairs to the newsroom, and I stood in front of the breaking news desk, and they put a microphone on me, and they said, there's been an explosion at the Boston Marathon, and you're on in 10, 9. And I said, could you tell me what happened? You know, I'm envisioning a million people that I'm going to have to tell something to, and I don't know what it is. And they said, there have been 2 explosions. It's at the finish line. We don't know anything more than that. You've been at the finish line of the marathon. We'll tell you what happens as we find out, and you're on in 5, 4. And then I started seeing the faces of the people in the newsroom when they were watching the video feed, the video that was coming in, the live feeds from the marathon. And I couldn't see the video. I couldn't see what they were seeing. I could only see their faces as the video came in. And I saw a writer burst into tears. I saw a producer, you know, clasp his hands to his cheeks in horror. And I thought, something terrible is happening. Something terrible is happening. And it's my responsibility to describe it in a way that's straightforward and fair and responsible. And I remember my knees were shaking. You know, I remember thinking, I don't know what's happened, but I do know my life will never be the same. And then I thought, how am I going to do this? How am I going to do this? And I thought, just tell, you're a storyteller, Hank. You're a storyteller. Just tell the story. And that's what I did for the next week, and that's what all of us reporters did for the next week. We all lived through exactly the same thing by getting the story and telling the story. And I can tell you, you know, when it was over on that Saturday, the Saturday after it was over, my husband and I were out at Dunkin' Donuts getting coffee, and I saw a little boy and his mom sharing a blueberry muffin. And I just burst into tears. I just burst into tears. And my husband says, sweetheart, why are you crying at the muffin? And I said, because we got our normal back. The world is normal again, because we never knew whether that would actually happen. And that's the life of a reporter. That's the life of a storyteller. You don't know what's around the next corner. And that's exactly the same as being a crime fiction author. You're telling a story. And the other thing that links crime fiction and investigative reporting is secrets. Is secrets. Who has a secret? Who knows the secret? Who's going to tell the secret? And what happens when the truth is told? I mean, every one of those Emmys that you mentioned, every one of those shiny statues, every one of those 32 Emmys represents a secret that someone didn't want you to know, right? That's what that is. A secret that someone called me or emailed or wrote to me about, a secret that we uncovered and that we got to present to you. And that's exactly the same thing that drives good crime fiction, is secrets. Who has the secret? Who knows the secret? And what will happen when the truth is told? What will happen when the truth is told? Now, this is so fabulous, because another connection is, remember I told you that we did the story that won the Emmys and changed three laws about foreclosure fraud and mortgage fraud and financial fraud. Not only did we change the world a little bit with that story, but it changed my world tremendously, because I got a really good idea for a crime fiction novel. I was covering an eviction. My photographer and I were covering an eviction, and you know what that looks like. The house was empty, and the deputies, the constables, were inside cleaning it out, getting it ready for the bank to take over this house. Someone had lost their home as a result of some disaster or some problem or some catastrophe. So we're watching this take place, and we see, you know, a chair come out a window, and we see the workers are sweeping the floors and cleaning the place out. You know what that looks like, getting ready for the bank to take over. And at one moment, I saw a guy come to the front door, and he was silhouetted in this open front door of the empty house with his arm sort of out like this. And I said to my photographer, something's gone on in there. Something's gone on in that house. There's something wrong. And my photographer said, yeah, it does look like there's something wrong. And I said, what if they found a dead body in the back room? And my photographer says, what are you talking about? His face was just like yours, like, what is she talking about? But I'm a crime fiction author. And when I see something that's out of whack or different or unusual, I begin to wonder if I can make a story out of that. So I began to think, you know, here's the law enforcement officials. They go into this empty home. They're throwing things the window, they're sweeping the floors, they're wiping down the halls, they go into the living room and clean it, they go into the dining room and clean it, they go into the first bedroom and clean it, they go into the second bedroom and clean it, and then in the last room, they open the last closet, and inside is a dead body. And that means, I thought, the police have ruined their own crime scene. The police have ruined their own crime scene. And at that moment, I thought, my book, I can do this. And if you've read Truth Be Told, you'll see that that is the opening scene of the book. Now, in real life, there wasn't, not that I know of at least, there wasn't a dead body in the back of that house. But that's what happens to fiction. My books are ripped from my own headlines, is how I look at it. They're not my stories made into fiction. But think of the experiences that I've had. As I said, I've gone undercover and in disguise and carried a hidden camera. I've been in prisons. I've been in the basements of courthouses. I know what the back offices of district attorney's offices look like. I've had people confess to murder. I've had convicted murderers swear that they were innocent. And I know what people look like when they're lying. And all of these things, I've been a reporter for 40 years. People ask me, do you do a lot of research? And I say, I've been doing research for 40 years, right? I just didn't realize it. If I had realized it, I would have taken better notes. However, so that's what I do. I take my real life situations and I polish them and tweak them and inject them with some adrenaline. And that's what becomes my novels. It's a joy and it's fabulous. I'm just checking to see. So here's the thing about it though. Here's the thing. I'm the poster child for following your dreams at midlife. You know, I didn't start writing fiction until I was 55, which was 10 years ago. At a time when people might think, you know, you're fine, you've had a wonderful career, you've done a lot of good, it's time for you just to retire and relax. But that little girl in the hayloft wanted to write a mystery novel. You know, I always wanted to write a mystery novel. And when I had a good idea for one, I said to my husband, I'm just gonna do this. If not now, when, I thought. And that is my message to you. You know, what is it that you wanna do with your life? If you take nothing from tonight, except my book. If you take nothing from tonight, I want you to understand that it is never too late to follow your dreams. What is it that you want to do? You know, write your book, write your memoir, write that book of poetry, put together those recipes that your family always wanted you to do, take a trip, make a change someone's life. You know, you can do that. It is not too late to do that. I don't want you to wake up 6 months from now and say, I regret. I could have done that. I could have tried that. The time is going to go by whether you do the thing or not. So why not just do it? It's a joy. Do you know the folk singer Judy Collins? Do you know Judy? Okay, I'm so glad to see you nodding your head. My husband and I went to hear Judy Collins at Sanders Theater at Harvard, gosh, a year now or so ago. I told my producer, who's in her 30s, I said, Jonathan and I are going to go hear Judy Collins at Sanders Theater. And she says, oh, clearly no idea about who that was. So I said, Judy Collins, the folk singer, you know, she sang Both Sides Now. I said, I couldn't have gotten through college without listening to her records. And Mary says, records? No, she didn't really. It was funny, right? But it's not true. Anyway, Jonathan and I went to hear Judy Collins. She's still fabulous. She's gorgeous. She's 72. She's got all this white hair, and she's thin, and her voice is still great. And she told us the story, and here's the point, because I know you were wondering. She told us the story about when she was a little girl, she lived in Denver. And her parents had told her that her destiny was to be a concert pianist, that she was going to be a concert pianist, and they made her practice and take lessons, and she was extremely talented at it. But she said she knew, from the moment she knew anything about her life, that she wanted to be a folk singer, that that's what she wanted to do. And she told us that she said, at age 19, I decided I'd had it with the concert pianist life. I wasn't gonna do it. She said, at age 19, I packed my bags and I moved to New York and I took all my songs with me. And then she said, of course, I hadn't written any of them yet. I hadn't written any of them yet. And it just touched me, you know, because I think we all have songs. We all have songs. We just have to make sure that we write them. And we're the ones who can do it. We're the only ones who can do it. We have to realize our power. Do you know the Stephen Sondheim musical, Sunday in the Park with George? Have you seen this? Do you know this? It's a marvelous Sondheim musical about the French impressionist, pointillist painter George Seurat. And in it, there's a scene where Seurat, the actor, comes out on stage and he has a blank sketch pad. And he draws on it, he draws a hat on the sketch pad. And he looks at it and he sings. I'm not going to sing. That would be a tragedy. He sings, look, I made a hat where there never was a hat. And it sounds funny, but it's a song about realizing that he has just created something beautiful and tangible and shareable out of nothing. He has made art. He has made beauty only from his imagination, only using his brain. And it's a song of joy about creativity, about how we as human beings are the only creatures who can do that. We can make something beautiful out of nothing, out of just our imagination. And we can share that, and we can give that to others, and we can show people that beauty. And that's what I do every day at home when I'm writing my books. I'm making hats. I'm making a new world out of my imagination. I'm writing about Jane Ryland, the investigative reporter in Boston who keeps getting fired. I'm writing about Jake Brogan, the cool, hip Boston police detective who solves murder cases with the passion of his grandfather, who was once the police commissioner. I'm writing stories about Boston and New England, places that you'll understand and know about, places where people shovel out their parking spots and put a chair in them, places where people can order a coffee regular and they know what that means. I'm writing about the Mass Pike, and when my husband and I are driving on the Mass Pike, and I'll say, oh, exit 17, this is where Jane was chased by the bad guy. And then I think, no, I made that up. So the books obviously resonate with people across the country. One of my favorite reviews of Truth Be Told said, in Ryan's adroit hands, even foreclosures can be sexy. So that's a good review. So making hats. And the thing that I've learned about making my hats, making my crime fiction hats, is that the books don't come into their own, aren't fully realized until you read them. I can make these worlds, but they don't come alive until you share the books. That's the key. Someone was telling me tonight, I read your book. I loved The Other Woman. And I said to her, this is what they don't tell you, that people are going to read your books and love them, and they're going to share that world. That makes the books come alive. And you all have changed my life with that. It's just amazing. When I finished writing my first book, I called my husband into the room and I said, sweetheart, watch this. And I typed the end. And then I burst into tears. Because I knew no matter what happened after that, I had followed my dreams. I had done what I always wanted to do. But of course, I shouldn't have cried when I typed the end, because it wasn't the end at all. It was the beginning of this wonderful new second half of my life and career. And I'm so pleased and honored that you invited me here tonight to share that with you. Thank you so much. You want to take some questions? But first, I'll be happy to answer any questions that you have. Easy questions. Anybody have a question? Yes.
Uh-huh. And I'm wondering if you have any insight into why this area of the country, this area of the state, has so many authors. And the other part of the question is, do you do networking with all of these wonderful authors that are in this part of the state?
The wonderful question is, what is it about Massachusetts that engenders so many wonderful authors? And you know what? That's a great question, and I have no idea. I don't know whether because I didn't grow up here, I came here. I think that there is a marvelous atmosphere of sharing and questioning and hard work and devotion and the literary legacy, starting with Emerson and Thoreau and, on through, this is to Tess Gerritsen and Julia Spencer Fleming and, all the people, Joe Finder, you could name people who live in New England. I don't know if it's because it's so cold that we spend the winters inside and we have to do something. you know, I think if you go to California, it's the same. If you go to Texas, if you go to Chicago, if you go to St. Louis, that's, if you go to Florida, each region has its marvelous authors. But you're so wise to recognize how many wonderful authors are here in New England. And yes, we're all dear pals. I mean, Catherine Hall Page took me under her wing when I started writing, Joe Finder and Bill Martin and all these people who I revere and look up to. You know, we're now friends. We call each other for advice. We attend each other's book launches. It's a marvelous community which has welcomed me. And part of the joys of my life too now is to welcome new authors into that community too. You know, there's no elbowing each other out of the way. There's no cutthroat competition about books, because if you love reading, you'll love reading all of our books. So if you love Hallie Efron's books, you'll love mine too. So we all help each other, and we're all enthusiastic about each other, and we all love the glory of finding the next new book. Yeah, it's great. Don't you think? Yeah, absolutely so. Who else? Sometimes people, go ahead.
You often hear the phrase thrown about, truth is stranger than fiction. Do you ever find that to be true? Obviously, you're very imaginative, but do you ever find that there are true things that you use in your fiction?
Truth is stranger than fiction. Truth is definitely stranger than fiction. I was just at an event last night with Ace Atkins, who has taken over from Robert B. Parker, and his new book, Kickback, is just out. And if you're a Robert B. Parker fan, Ace Atkins has taken on this mantle, which is pretty amazing and risky to do, and just done it brilliantly. So when you talk about truth is stranger than fiction, Ace Atkins, that's his real name, Ace Atkins, took over from Robert B. Parker. Robert B. Parker's nickname his whole life was Ace. So how if I put that in a book, you would say, come on, that's a coincidence. You know, you can't have a coincidence. My book, The Wrong Girl, came from a real life story that was so bizarre that I couldn't use the real story as the book because you would never have believed it. I'll tell it very quickly. The Wrong Girl came from a phone call that I got. A woman called me and she says, Hank, you should do a story about my cousin. She says, my cousin was given up for adoption at birth, and 26 years later, the adoption agency called her and said, your birth mother is looking for you. Would you like to meet her? And this woman thought about it for a moment. She said yes. And so she went up to New Hampshire and had tea with the woman who was supposed to be her birth mother. And she said, and Hank, they liked each other very much, but it soon became clear that this was not the girl's birth mother. She said, can you believe it, Hank? They sent that woman the wrong girl. And I thought, ha-ha, thank you. I can write a book about that. But the real reason, and I was thinking, was an adoption agency reuniting birth parents with the wrong children? You know, not only is that a good story for fiction, but that's a good story for television. And the real story turned out to be, and you tell me if you'd believe this if you saw it in a book, the real story turned out to be two cousins gave birth on the same day to infant daughters, unbeknownst to each other, they gave up their daughters for adoption to the same adoption agency. One woman's name was, I'm making this up, this is not their real name, Marie Williams, and the other woman's name was Mary Williams. 26 years later, the daughter of Marie Williams was looking for her birth mother, and Mary Williams was looking for her birth daughter, and the adoption agency just decided that they must be the same person, okay? So it was just a clerical error based on that two people with essentially the same name gave birth on exactly the same day and gave up their daughters to the adoption agency at exactly the same day. Now, if you read that in a book, right? No. Way, that would never happen. What?
Just making up.
Yeah, it's just, we call it author's convenience. Yeah. You know, author's convenience. Never, you'd throw that book against the wall and say, that can't be true. But that's the real story. That's the real story. And that's where The Wrong Girl came from. Now, The Wrong Girl plot is a much more believable plot, right? Because I made it up. which is a funny thing. Sometimes people ask me if I know the end of the books before I write them. And the answer is absolutely, I do not. I don't have any idea what's going to happen in the books. The only way I know what happens is to write the next line and the next paragraph and the next scene. Do you know this? There are two kinds of authors. One, Jeffrey Deaver, Ken Follett, they write incredibly complicated outlines. You know this. Jeffrey Deaver writes a 60-page outline, he says, for each book. He knows exactly what's going to happen. And it turns out that then writing the books is the, this is typing, writing the books is the easy part because he knows what the story is. He's just telling the story. Those people are called plotters because they plot out the story. People like Lee Child and Charlene Harris and I and Sue Grafton, we're what they call pantsers because we write by the seat of our pants. We have no idea what's going to happen next. Just do it. And so every day I'm surprised. Every day I'm surprised by what's happening. You know, because I'm setting out a story, just like I do as a reporter. I'm finding the clues and following the leads and setting out what happens, and people are talking to each other, and it's a surprise to me every time. And the problem with that is, of course, I may be setting up a mystery that I can't solve, you know, which is a problem. So, you know, about when I was writing Truth Be Told, about 80% of the way through, I came out and said to my husband, I don't think I can solve this crime. I don't think I can do this. And Jonathan says, well, you're 80% of the way through the book. At least you know who the bad guy is. And I'm like, no, I really don't. I didn't know who did it, and I didn't know why. And when I remember being, when I figured out the end, people say to me, I was so surprised by the end of Truth Be Told. And I said, yeah, me too. I mean, talk about a surprise ending. I surprised myself. I remember it so clearly. I was in my study, and I was just in despair. And when I thought of the ending, when it came to me, I was by myself, and I just stood up and applauded myself, like, oh, I'm so smart. So yeah, talk about a surprise ending. I surprised myself with Truth Be Told. And that is the joy of writing. Sue Grafton calls it the magic of mystery writing, that we just don't quite understand how our brains work and how those stories, if we're lucky, come to life. So it's a surprise every day, and I hope I continue to be surprised. My new book, which comes out in October, is called What You See. I hope you'll look for it. It's about privacy and surveillance and how every moment of our day is taped and surveilled. And I got the idea because I thought about those videos that we see on TMZ and whatever of actors trashing hotel rooms and athletes beating up people, and it's awful and scary. But then I began to wonder, what other video is there that we don't see? And who keeps it? And who's looking at it? And what are they doing with that? And how might they use that video? And that's what turned into What You See, and that comes out this fall. And again, I had no idea who the bad guy was in that book, and I was very thrilled when I discovered the answer. Who else has a question? Yes.
How did you actually learn the craft of writing fiction because it is different from nonfiction?
Being a reporter. It's kind of different. Writing crime fiction and being a reporter are different from the standpoint of writing the facts. But it is telling a story that has to have a beginning and a middle and an end. It has to carry you through. It has to have an arc. It has to be entertaining. It has to be educational. It has to be enlightening. It has to be new. It has to be compelling. It has to be unique. I mean, when you watch my TV stories, I don't want you to turn the channel. And when you're reading my books, I don't want you to put them down, right? I always imagine people reading my books on airplanes and being sad when they get to their destination. You know, they want just one more chapter. So there is an element of that storytelling that's very important. to both of those. And I think that, you know, people say, you know, I'd say I started writing crime fiction when I was 55. True. But I really started writing stories when I was 20. So the two things I had to learn, one, as I said earlier, was how to make stuff up. And the other was how to make my work longer and richer and bigger, because a television news story is going to be 4 minutes long. And a crime fiction novel is 100,000 words. So that's when I was about halfway through my first book, Primetime, that's when I realized that I had no idea what I was doing. And there was that moment. I mean, I thought, I've read hundreds of mysteries. How hard can it be? You know, and then I realized how hard it could be. And I called my mom, and I said to her, I love this book, but I'm not quite sure I can finish it. You know, it was called Primetime, won the Agatha for Best First Mystery. So something worked. But she said to me, I said, I'm not quite sure I can finish it. And my mom said, well, dear, you will if you want to. You will if you want to. So, and as I said, that book won the Agatha for Best First Mystery. So it's a combination of growth and experience and research and learning on the job and a lot of persistence and a lot of desire and a lot of passion for it. My first book, when I finished it, it was 723 pages long. Wow. You know, and it can only be 400 pages long. So I had to cut 403 pages. That's how I learned. That's how I learned to take out things that are boring and redundant and not funny and not clever and too long and all those things. And so I educated myself about it. And I read and read and read and read. And I began to read with an author's eye, not with a reader's eye. And that was another way. And I'm still learning. I think every book is better than the last. It's a process, and a wonderful process, a process that's crazy some days and scary some days, and you're walking a tightrope some days. You know, you're writing a story that you don't know how it will end. You know, that's a risk. But I even on the bad writing days, I still love it. Yes?
Do you have a daily writing schedule? You write, you know, from 8 in the morning until 11 o'clock at noon, and then the rest of the day is something else?
Yes. Do I have my writing schedule depends on what my day is. If I have a Channel 7 day, if I'm at Channel 7, that my husband and I drive to work together in the morning. My husband is a criminal defense attorney. Did you read the book Defending Jacob?
Yes.
Okay. Do you remember the lawyer in Defending Jacob, Jonathan, the silver-haired, bearded attorney? That's Jonathan. That's based on Jonathan. based on a case that he defended a young man. I know. Isn't that so cool? A little bit of literary info. So Jonathan and I drive to work together in the morning, and he drives, and I read the newspaper out loud to him in the car. And usually I try to see if I can make something up and, you know, pretend that it's in the news story that I'm reading it out loud to see whether he will catch it, that I've made something up. So we work from, you know, 9 till 6:30 and then drive home. And then on those days, I write from maybe 7 till 10 at night, and then we have dinner. So cooking was the first to go in the juggling of the two jobs. On a day that I don't go to Channel 7, I get my administrative stuff done in the morning, answer emails and that kind of thing, and then I carve out 3 or 4 hours to completely focus on work. And I know how many words I have to write a day. I figured it out just like doing math, figured out how many words I have to write a day to be finished by 2 months before the deadline for the book, so I can have 2 months to work on editing and revision. And I just do that. I fill in a little chart, I'll tell you. I fill in a little chart that says how many words I did so I can know where I am. Because when you have so much to juggle as a reporter and a crime fiction author and a wife and a grandmother and, you know, I'm out here doing speeches and I teach classes and seminars and writing now, which surprises me, you have to be organized. You have to be organized. So I try to carve out that time. I demand myself to carve out that time. And sometimes I even set a timer. and I say, I'm not doing anything until this timer goes off. I'm not going to think about anything else except this book until that timer goes off. Because you have to be immersed in the world of your book. You can't be distracted. And that's the author's big dilemma, is when there's this whole world out there, how do you just focus on that one laser crystalline thing, which is your book, which is the most important thing in the world?
Another question for you. When do you decide what the title's going to be?
When do I decide what the title's going to be is such a great story. We all authors talk about this all the time, because it's so important. You know, it's so important. The other woman was the other woman from moment one. You know, I was reading a story about Mark Sanford, the ex-governor of South Carolina, you know who I mean, who told his wife and family that he was off hiking the Appalachian Trail, and he was really off with the other woman. And I was in the dentist's office waiting for a root canal, actually, and reading this article in People magazine about Mark Sanford. And I started to wonder, why would someone be the other woman? Why would you do that? It's just such a silly, dumb, ridiculous, life-ruining thing. And then there was a line in that story that said, a quote from someone who said, you can choose your sin, but you cannot choose your consequences. And I thought, my book. And that quote is on the cover of The Other Woman, and that book was always going to be called The Other Woman. So that book was called The Other Woman before I started writing it. The Wrong Girl was called The Wrong Girl. Clearly, that was what the title was going to be before I started writing it. Now, truth be told, that was a tough one, because I wanted to call it As Good as True, and my agent hated that title, like a lie is as good as the truth. I wanted to call it The Good Liar, because it may be it's about someone who tells lies, but he's a good guy, and it may be about somebody who is good at lying. And so there seemed to be all kinds of layers in that, and my agent didn't like that. So I thought, what about No Good Deed? Because it's about mortgages and people sneaking into homes and, you know, banking and all that sort of stuff. I mean, they're murder mysteries. You know this. They're fun, fast-paced murder mysteries that take place in Boston and New England. If you like Tess Gerritsen, Harlan Coben, Lisa Scottolini, those Dennis Lehane, those are, you know, that's what these are. They're murder mystery. So I wanted to call it No Good Deed, and my agent says, yes, that's a great title, but it's a Laura Lippman book. So then I thought, what about One False Move? And she says, because it was somebody moving into homes. And she says, yes, that's a great title. That's a Harlan Coben book. So we had to figure out a new title. And truth be told is what Jane Ryland, the main character, is an investigative reporter. That's what she says all the time. And that's what she does, is tell the truth. So it's about, and this is about a mortgage banker turned Robin Hood who decides to manipulate mortgage records to keep people's homes out of foreclosure. And it's also about a cold case, the Lilac Sunday killing, a murder in the Arnold Arboretum, unsolved from 20 years ago. And it's also about a reporter who makes stuff up. So it's all about truth be told. And when I said truth be told, I thought, there it is. There it is.
So nobody else takes it.
Oh, yeah. Would that you could patent a title, but you can't copyright or patent a title. And what you see was always what you see, because it's about surveillance and how what you see may not always be the truth. You know, you think you're seeing the truth, but what you see may be something else entirely. So that's what you see. And the new one after that is called Say No More, about witness intimidation. So that makes a lot of sense. So we'll see. Titles are hard, and titles are marvelous. So it makes a lot of difference. Okay, I think we're, I'll tell you, my last thing is two things. One is, I can't believe you didn't ask me. Thank you, but it's Harriet Ann. Exactly. Again, the books are usually $26, but they're 20 tonight. I'm happy to sign them for you, happy to sign them as a gift, a Father's Day present or a graduation present, birthday present, or just for you to tuck away in your closet for those moments when you think, I need a housewarming present, I don't have anything, and I can't wrap up a candle. So
Kindle. Thank, I've got books I don't start with.
Oh, okay, that's good. I've wrapped up many a candle and said, this will work. I'm so grateful that you're here tonight. Thank you so much for coming, and I hope you'll invite me back.
Thank you.